Hi, my name is Françoise. I'm a research scientist at Google, and I'm going to talk to you about federated learning. First, cover the basics, and then walk our way towards applications to the mobile keyboard. So the outline of the talk will be a brief intro on federated learning, motivations, how it works. And then we'll do a little bit of intro to mobile keyboards to understand why machine learning is needed there. Then we'll put the two together. We'll talk about how federated learning works in the context of where we wanted to deploy it in mobile keyboards, and then we'll talk about the actual applications. The motivations for doing federated learning are the following. When you do traditional machine learning, you need data sets that typically reside on a server. They get split into training set, test sets. And with that data, you can train and test a model, typically nowadays a neural network. And that model can be then deployed in an application that's server side, where more logging can be done to gather more data to further refine the model. But what if we want to deploy that model on the device? In that case, logging is harder to explain. So if possible, what we would want to do is to keep the learning on the device as well. And that's what federated learning allows us to do. It's a privacy-sensitive solution to the question of how do we keep refining models when they have been deployed on the device. And so the solution that federated learning is proposing is to keep the user's raw data on the device, to bring the computations to the device to do learning there, and then to aggregate learnings across different users and combine them server side to come up with a new model that can be downloaded on the devices again. And so the rounds and rounds of training that happen that way. So what are the ingredients needed to do federated learning? Well, first of all, we need phones that act as supercomputers on which we're doing computations. Then we need data. The data, again, stays on the user's device. And then we need, of course, new algorithms, new protocols to make it all work together. So let me explain quickly how federated learning works at a high level. And then later on in the talk, we'll go into a deeper explanation of how it works. So you have a server here, which is in the cloud, and there's data. Those are the two little disks there. And the server comes up with a model. We'll talk more about how we do that later. So that's an initial model. Now we have a device that has its own data that's stored on the device, and those are the little disks there in a different color. And the device talks to the server. And the server talks to the device. And the device says, do you need me? And the server most often says, no, not now. But occasionally the server will say, yes, I do need you. I do need you to perform some learning task that is needed for federated learning. And so at that point, what will happen is that the server will prepare this initial model and it will push it through a download on the device that is available for training. And the device will start training, starting from that model and based on the data that it has in its own little data store. And there isn't only one device doing that. There's a whole bunch of devices. So each one of them is iterating on their own data. And then they upload these new models to the server, and the server aggregates the different models to come up with a new model that has a little bit of the learning from all those devices. And then the server, of course, can push that model back onto the devices in the download, and we can do more rounds of training. So now let's talk a little bit about mobile keyboards. I'll try to explain to you why machine learning and AI are needed in a mobile keyboard. And when we talk about keyboards here, since I work at Google, we're talking about Gboard, which is the Google mobile keyboard. So I'll tell you a little bit about what it is, what it does, why it needs machine learning, and why specifically federated learning. You have here on the left a little picture of a keyboard and me typing something to my family. And you see that there are next word predictions there. I typed last night in San, and I meant to say San Francisco, which is where I took the picture, right? And you see in the suggestions trip, it offers Francisco or Diego or Jose. So the keyboard, the Gboard keyboard has over 1 billion installs. So it's a very large basis. It's a keyboard that allows layouts for over 960 languages, almost 1,000 languages. And one property that's very interesting in the context of this talk is that 80% of the usage happens in chat apps, which means that it's very private data, where learning technique based on a privacy preserving or privacy aware technique is very interesting. So next word prediction is one feature that Gboard has, but it's not the only one. The keyboard can also offer emoji prediction. It has speech recognition. It allows you to do gesture typing. And each one of these functionalities is supported by a machine learning model. And of course, that model needs data to be refined. So you would say, well, yes, it has machine learning, but does it really need to have machine learning? Does it need that level of sophistication? And I'm trying to give you here one example of why I think machine learning is welcome. So on the left picture, you have here overlaid on the keyboard layout, the touch points of a bunch of users typing the word could. And what you see is essentially a big messy cloud. And it's really hard if you see only that to figure out what these users might have been typing. On the right, you see the same picture after a lot of processing and normalization. And you see that now if we were to follow that trajectory from cyan to red, we would be able much more easily to identify what users might have been typing as the word could, because you can really see how those dots become connected essentially and how to decrypt what the user was doing. So if you think about it that way, Gboard is really a really good test set or a test bed to do federated learning. First of all these features are very complicated and require machine learning to work very well. It's very private data, so we prefer not to log it. And the models are already running on the device because we want the keyboard to be extremely snappy and we want it to be very reliable. You don't want your keyboard to stop responding because, you know, you happen to be in an area that doesn't have connectivity. Also, Gboard has 1 billion+ downloads, so a large usage base, which allows us to leverage many different devices to learn from. And finally, users are naturally incentivized to correct errors that happened in the keyboard. So if, for example, you mistyped something before you send that message to a friend, you probably will correct what was mistyped. And so that gives very good supervision signals that we can learn from. So let's now talk about making federated learning work in practice. And what I mean by that is taking the algorithms, taking the infrastructure and building models and what it takes to build models that can go into a consumer product. So we'll talk first about the overall computation flow. Then we'll talk more specifically about what happens on the devices, what happens on the servers, and then how to get the two to work together. So the picture that you see here is similar to the one that you saw before. If you remember, there was the little client on the left and the server in the cloud on the right. The difference here is that we're going deeper into the algorithm. And so what you see is that we start by coming up with a model, an initial model on the server side, and then we do rounds of training. And so in each round of training, we select a set of clients on which we will train. And for each client, we do a client update. So now if we go to the left panel, we see the client update with what happens there. And first of all, we're getting the data, right? The little two disks there. And then we split that data into different batches and we do epochs of training on those batches. When that is done, the client returns an updated set of weights, so an updated model to the server. And the server gets all those updates from different devices and can combine them, aggregate them into a new model based on which it can do the next round of training. So let's look a little bit more in details at what happens on the client side. So as we said, there is training happening on the device there. So there is TensorFlow code that needs to be downloaded on the model, on the device. Of course, we don't want that code to be too big, right? Because all that code has to reside there on a small phone. So we developed this concept of pruning graph. And the concept there is that out of the whole library of operations that TensorFlow allows, we're selecting only those that we need for the task at hand. And that obviously reduces the size of the library quite a bit. The disadvantage, of course, is that as a developer, when you have some thoughts about a new model that you want to try or a new technique you want to try, maybe you need different operators. And the TFOps that you need may not be on the device at that moment. At that point, you will essentially, as an engineer, as a developer, you will need to wait till the next client software update so that you can push the new op on the device and you can use it. So working with federated learning definitely needs a lot of thinking and planning ahead to have all the material that you need on the devices where you can run it. The other thing to be aware of is that as anyone who works on machine learning and AI in general very well knows is that data is always noisy, right? And in this case, the way that it happens is because the language that people use when they chat is very informal. A normal user will be very happy to type a sentence like "I'm going to New York" with no caps and no apostrophes. But of course, the model that we want to learn, we would like that model to be, you know, as clean as possible and to know that New York should be capitalized and that "I'm going" should have an apostrophe there. And so those are things that are not technically that hard to do. It just takes a few normalizers to be written. But often those normalizers have been written for the purpose of server-side computation and processing. And that means that the code is typically large and needs to be made portable to run on the device. But the models themselves that do this normalization tend to be large too, because if you're running them server-side, it's not a concern what their size is. You only care about the accuracy of the model. And so one of the things that we had to do was to take these models that we had and shrink them quite a bit, like orders of magnitude, to make them fit. The other thing to be aware of is that, of course, when you do machine learning and training of neural networks, there's a whole bunch of hyperparameters that need to be optimized, like the batch size, the number of epochs, the learning rate, and all these things have to be optimized carefully if you want to get the best possible accuracy without getting into a place where either it trains too slowly or it might diverge. Right? Neural nets have this tendency, if they don't have the right hyperparameter at times, to completely diverge and blow up. And as you can imagine, if you've trained neural networks, if a neural network diverges, you say, well, you know, too bad, just restart from scratch with different hyperparameters and everything is fine. But when you're training it on users' devices and you need all those devices to report back, you don't want a fraction of those models to have diverged, right? Because the overall average wouldn't be a very good quality. And so we had to develop techniques to make the learning really rock solid. And one technique that we found to be very helpful is to do an appropriate amount of gradient clipping to make sure that the models wouldn't diverge over time. The other thing to think about is that when you're learning from different devices, you won't find the same amount and the same nature of data on each one of these devices. Some people type a lot, some people type a lot less. You may have someone who has not typed for a week because they just went to the beach, and maybe someone else has been working on their PhD thesis and typed a ton of stuff there. So we need to find algorithms that are robust to this mix of conditions and hyperparameters that allow us to learn from all those devices at the same time. So that's what's happening on the client side. But now let's look at what's happening on the server side. So on the server side, like we said, the rounds of training, right? And these rounds of training can actually be pretty slow if we don't pay attention to it. For example, in Gboard, the language model that we learned, there are about 1.4, 1.5 million parameters, so nothing really big. But they take about 600 rounds to converge from scratch, and around, at least when we started working on this, took about 5 minutes. So you can imagine it's quite a lot of time to learn what amounts to a fairly small model. So we wanted to find a way of reducing that training time, which means both reducing the time that it takes to make one round and the number of rounds. And one way that we could do that was by realizing that when we aggregate the updates that we get from different devices, we don't need to do just a simple summation, right? We keep on doing these updates and we can learn something from them over time. We could use a momentum based algorithm on the server side. And as you see on the left panel, it gave us quite a bit of accuracy improvements in addition to training faster. So that was a good find there. The other thing that can improve quite a bit is to start with a good model. Of course, we can start with a random model, so we can just, you know, pick the configuration we care about and have random weights. But if instead of doing that, and instead of learning from scratch, we pre-train that model with data that we find somewhere, even if it's not the best data, that helps. So for example, we want to learn a language model that knows about, you know, the type of language that we use in English when we're chatting with friends. It doesn't mean that the model needs to be trained to start with that type of language. But if we take web documents, for example, that provide a ton of data and just pre-train the model with that, at least we have a model of, you know, common English language. And that's already a good point to start. With that type of model and pre-training, what we found is that to reach a reasonably good level of accuracy, it took us 350 rounds from scratch, but only 80 rounds when the model had been pre-trained in such a manner. Also, for those of you who are familiar with differential privacy, which is not something that we'll touch upon in this talk, pre-training is also beneficial for privacy because it allows us to consume less of the privacy budget. So once we've talked about both what happens on the server and what happens on the device, then we need to think about how the two interact and the global orchestration of the learning. And in the first question that comes up is, what do we require from a device to be part of a federated training? Of course, if the device is very limited in capabilities, maybe because it's an old device, then that device may not be appropriate to provide training for a model that might be large, right? So we need to tailor the population of devices to the task at hand. The other thing is that we want to make sure that the training doesn't disturb the user. And what I mean by that is that we do federated learning only when the device is plugged in and charging so that it doesn't deplete the battery. When the device is connected to Wi-Fi, to a meter to Wi-Fi, so that there's no bandwidth costs. And also that the device is idle for a period of time. And the reason being, of course, that we don't want the training to slow down the device if the user is using it at the moment. So whenever a server goes to a population of devices and says, you know, I would like some devices to participate in this learning task, we check all these conditions. So it is actually the device themselves who decide that they are in a condition such that they can participate. And so they say, you know, I'm ready to participate, to check in, to do some task for you, for the server. Now, of course, if too many devices offer their help to do a round of training, let's say 2,000 devices report, but the task has been defined in such a way that we need only 300 devices, then the server will tell all these devices that aren't needed that they may go away. They may go away now, they're not needed at the moment, and they shouldn't even come back anytime soon. And so this dance of, you know, how much the server wants to send away the devices and how much it wants them to be involved in learning is what we call the pace steering, which is this algorithm that governs when and for how long to send data to send away unneeded clients. Of all the devices that present themselves to the server will pick only a subset of them. And the other devices that are not needed will be sent away, right? And so the server will say, I don't need you devices at the moment, and you can go away for a period of time because I don't need you right away, right? To prevent all those devices from coming back. And that's this dance between how much the server wants to send away clients and tell them that they don't need to come back, and how much it wants them to come back so that at the next round of training they're there to participate, is what we call the pace steering. So the pace steering is this algorithm that governs when and for how long to send away unneeded clients. And pace steering, the optimization of that algorithm, is actually quite important. So what this plot is showing you is the number of rounds completed per hour over a period of a few days. And you see it going up and down, right? That's the day-night pattern. Like we said, we perform federated learning only when the device is not used. And of course, the likelihood that the device isn't used is higher during the night. So we perform more rounds of training during the night, and then you have a dip during the day and then a peak again at the next night. And what you see to the right of the plot is that one day that year, around the 19th, 20th of October, we made improvements to the algorithm. And you see that all of a sudden, we have twice as many rounds completing per hour. So the optimization of that algorithm is really crucial to get the most out of the training population. And so when we put all these mechanisms and optimization together, that's where we can train really accurate model. So what you see here on the left is a server-trained model compared to the baseline, which is the dotted line. And this model is doing next word prediction, and we're showing the accuracy of the center prediction on the suggestion strip. And so you see a model trained there, and then on the right, you see the same model, same architecture, but trained with federated learning. And you see that the improvement that we get with the federated learning that we've optimized and with all those tweaking of parameters gave us 24% relative better accuracy of our prediction, which was a nice win after many, many months of work and optimization. Okay, so now we understand how mobile keyboards work. We understand federated learning. So let's put it all together and talk about specific applications. So the first one, we've touched upon it, of course, is next word prediction. So you have a little bit of specifications of the baseline model here before we did federated learning. But one thing to know about it is that it's a fairly small model. It can predict about 64,000 words. And instead, the federated model that we trained is based on a neural network, a recurrent neural network of the LSTM type. It has only 10,000 words. But as you see on the right, when we trained that model and we put it in production and we got production metrics, we saw that the accuracy was actually 24% higher, as we said previously, with the new model. And that made it such that users were using predictions more. And so we had a 10% increase in click-through rate, so at the rate at which users are clicking on the prediction strip. So clearly, this model brought an improvement in the way that the user is interacting with the keyboard. And so once we're done with the next word prediction model, we said, well, you know, maybe we can do something else. Let's try predicting emoji. And the thing that's difficult about emoji is the following. Like, everybody loves emoji, right? Everybody loves putting a little drawing in there, but there are kind of hard to reach when you have a keyboard and you have to search for the proper emoji. And so the result of that is that the emojis that people are using in practice are fairly limited. It's the LOL, the smiley, these like top 5 or 10 emoji. And so the distribution is very long tail. So if you want to build a machine learning model that predicts emoji that are more in the tail to give more variety to the user, it takes quite a bit of engineering to get there, essentially. But we could do it. And so we could show a thing like a bonfire, right, in the prediction strip. And when we put that model in production, we saw not only that users were clicking more on the prediction strip to choose to pick one of those emojis, but also that they started sharing a lot more emojis in absolute, like 11% more emojis. And that is quite remarkable because, again, users already have a way of sharing emoji by going to the emoji tree. But also, this is just the keyboard. And the keyboard is used in the context of an app that itself most often already has a mechanism for picking emoji. So those are all emoji shares on top of all that, indicating that clearly we were able to bring in emoji that were pleasant to users and that they wanted to include in their typing. And so another thing that we've done is learning new words. The keyboard has a list of allowed words, and those are words that have been manually created to not have typos and things like that, right? Which means that it's a static list. And language is anything but static, right? There are new names, new expressions that come up in natural language all the time. And so we developed a neural network that works at the character level and that allows us to learn character sequences and that can surface new words. So it will surface a whole list of words. Some of them, of course, are just typos or expressions that we don't necessarily want to put in the allow list. But some of them, like proper names, maybe of people are coming up in the news because of some event at that time. And so we can learn those words and choose to put them in the list if we want to. Another thing is you may have noticed in a previous slide that the baseline model is an n-gram, meaning a model that's fairly simple, very fast, but fairly simple. And the way federated learning is set up, at least in our toolkit at the moment, is that it fits better in the context of neural networks. So we had to find a way of learning a neural network and then projecting that neural network onto an n-gram topology that we could bring back into the keyboard. And we managed to do that and get an improvement of quality there too. So what I mean by this slide is that we could use federated learning also to learn a model that is not a neural network. We started with a neural network and then we transferred that knowledge to a different type of architecture, and that worked as well. Now, yet another thing that can be done with federated learning is to use it in a slightly simplified way to do personalization. So imagine that we do federated learning, but instead of uploading the new models that we've learned at each round of training and then average them and update the model, imagine that we just keep running on each one of the devices. We keep iterating over time, right? What will happen there is that on each device, we will have a model that we have learned more and more about its user, and that will be more appropriate for that user. And that's the goal of personalization. So on the right-hand side, what you see is a histogram of devices and the improvements that we get from personalization. Now, when you have a very large number of devices and you do personalization on top of them, there will always be a fraction of devices for which personalization actually makes things a little bit worse, right? It's really hard to get improvements throughout the whole set of users. However, federated learning comes, or at least our toolkit comes with mechanisms by which a new model is tested before it is put in front of the user. And that's what the dotted line is indicating there. All the models for which we can measure a positive improvement, those models will be present it to the user to replace the model that they were using, let's say, the day before. But for those devices where we see a negative improvement or regression in typing experience, we just block it there. We don't present that model to the user, and the user will keep their basic model unpersonalized, but with no regression. And so the improvements that we get through personalization obviously depend on the user and on the device, but you see that lots of users have modest improvements, and then a fraction of almost a fourth of the devices got really good improvement. And interestingly, but not surprisingly, it is those devices where there is the most data that could best benefit from the data and get the biggest improvements in quality. So in the end, if I have to summarize it, productizing federated learning is hard, right? It took us a lot of work to minimize the models, to minimize the code, make it portable, to do things like normalizers, capitalizers that would run on device, to optimize all the hyperparameter, be it on the server side and the client side. But hey, you know, we did it. And we put all these models in production, and we could do it and get improvements and a better typing experience for users. And so if you're interested in learning more and you want to learn it in a fun way, there is a comic strip that our colleagues have written there. You can follow the pointer and read the comics. If instead you want to read more technical stuff, there's a bunch of tech papers here that go into the details of all the algorithms and experiments. Obviously, there's a huge literature by now on federated learning. This is just the sample of papers that's relevant to this specific talk. And that's it. Thank you.